Welcome to A Celtic State of Mind. I'm Paul John Dykes, and once again, I'm joined by Anthony Haggerty. We're talking about the post-match after Celtic won their second game on a row, Tony, 2-1 against Motherwell. But I tell you what, after that first half, it was the two faces of Celtic. I think after the 65th minute, we seen the other side of Celtic, the Celtic that almost threw that game in the 93rd minute, and we were relying on Laxalt clearing one off the line. You know, the goal, obviously we'll talk about the goal, the goalkeeper situation, but what was your thoughts if you compare that second half to the first?
First half, total dominance, right up until the 66th minute till Motherwell scored. And you say to yourself, one setback has upset the rhythm of that whole team. Mm-hmm. That's all it took. One goalkeeping error, because I don't know about you, unless that's taken a deflection somewhere along that, that's meeting down to a goalkeeper. He should be plucking that out of the air. I mean, when the boy hit the shot, I was just like, right, okay. Couldn't believe that it ended up in the net. You know, and for a goalkeeper, I suppose, a quality like Bain, I don't know what he's thinking there. You know, and but that's just upset the whole rhythm of Celtic.
Yeah, it know? Has.
And as you say, we've ended up having to clear one off the line in a match that for three quarters of the game you dominated. Mm-hmm. Absolutely dominated. But then, we'll talk about it as well, but the substitutions baffled me as well.
I think one of them baffled David Turnbull by the looks of his face.
Well, he was raging, wasn't he? Mm-hmm. Did he stop Bubble? He was probably thinking, me? Seriously? And Tom Rogic still in the park? Mm-hmm. I mean, the second goal was a brilliant football goal. I don't know how many passes were there, but somebody might count it on Sports or whenever. Or, you know, but Turnbull was heavily involved in that goal.
Yeah.
Right? He's a baller. He's the one that makes things happen. When you're needing a third goal to clinch that those 3 points, and you take the most creative midfielder on the park, arguably the best footballer on the park, off, and then you take an outlet in Taylor, who was fizzing some great balls across, and yet he's a stud away from making it 3-0 at one point. Mm-hmm. And you bring on Laxalt. Well, Laxalt's obviously cleared that one off the line, but I took any momentum that you had, even at 2-1, right out of the game. I mean, the manager, I can't, that's inexplicable to me.
It is, Tony, and Treble makes the point on YouTube. For everybody who's watching on YouTube, keep subscribing to the channel. We're going out every single day with new content. We made hard work of that win. Now, John McGackie comes in also to say, back to our old failings in the second half. Subs baffling again. I've got to agree with that part of John's point. I am baffled by a lot of the subs this season. You know, and there was even one occasion in Europe where the coaching team were baffled. They weren't sure who was going on and who was coming off. It just seems almost as if it's just a process they're going through rather than trying to affect the game, Tony. You know, you're looking at Turnbull and you think, we mentioned it during the week, he's constantly taking off. I'd like to see the stats on how many games he's actually finished. So I would rather look at Rogic, who, by the way, showed some flashes of brilliance. We know what Rogic's capable of. But take Rogic off in that scenario. And again, Ayeti, yeah, Griffiths comes on for his 250th appearance for Celtic, but I think Ayeti needs the minutes in his legs.
Of course, I keep going back to this, right? If you and I can see that, why can't the management team see that? Why can't the management team see that David Turnbull's the best footballer at the club at this moment in time? Why can't they see that? Why is he coming off every game? Why are you taking a match winner and creative midfielder off the park in any game, regardless if he's playing poorly? But he wasn't playing poorly. And keeping a guy on like Rogic, who, as you say, fits and starts, that's utterly baffling. You had a guy, Taylor, charging down the wing, throwing cross in after cross, looking for the strikers to get in the end of it. You know, we could have been a bit more clinical with them, fair enough. But you see Ajeti come back into the team trying to get, you know, fitness into his legs. Let him play. Let him see it out. And he can maybe grab a goal, get confidence levels up again. You know, the goalkeeping situation, and I'm going to give Natasha credit here, because Natasha put out a tweet last night talking about various players that we let go, but one of them that she mentioned was Craig Gordon. Now, if Barkas was coming in to be your number one, you surely would have kept Craig Gordon just in case things didn't go right. as it's proven with Barkas, it didn't go right from the off.
Mm-hmm.
So, again, another baffling decision why you would let all that experience go. Now, Craig Gordon had his up and downs as a Celtic goalkeeper, but he was generally reliable between the sticks. You know, I thought he was still a great goalkeeper, decent goalkeeper. But we've struggled since we've brought Barkas in. This is our third goalkeeper we're on this season. We've tried Barkas, we've tried Bain, we've tried Hazard. You know, and it beggars belief, really, how... You know, I know you watch these guys in training, but surely, you know, you must have thought at one point, you know what, it's not wise to let Craig Gordon go at this moment in time because we don't have a settled goalkeeper.
It's unsettling for the defence. You've seen it all season, Tony.
Correct. The one, two shining lights today was Turnbull for me, and well, three, Eddie getting back to wee bit of sharpness, and the young boy Welsh. I thought he was absolutely terrific. You said in the first half, well, loves a tackle too, but just the very fact that you could have drawn that game, or worse still, I wouldn't say they could have lost it because Motherwell didn't create too much. Even the thought of drawing that game when you were so dominant for like 65, 66 minutes, you just wonder what's going on. And as I say, it just takes one thing
mm-hmm.
to upset everything.
To derail the plan, absolutely.
And to derail the players.
Mm-hmm.
Which, going back to what you were talking about with Callum McGregor, we don't know. You know, so when there's a setback, the guys don't know what's happening. You know, it was fine, it was hunky-dory, everything was great, first half, bump, 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 goal ahead, early second half, bump, lovely goal, great, cruising. You should be able to see that. Motherwell should have been hammered 4 or 5 nothing.
But we're going from almost going 3-0 up to hanging on for dear life in the 93rd minute with a goal line clearance.
Yeah, they should have been hammered 5-0.
Mm-hmm.
It should have been. Celtic team of old would have hammered them 5-0, maybe even more. They were that rampant and that dominant. So, what went wrong after the 66th minute?
You see, the thing with me as well, Tony, and I've been saying this all season, I always think, with regards to Celtic, is we've always been fitter. We've always been the fittest club. And we always go on about we've mentioned at half-time about the fairy tale season in the centenary year, the last-minute goals. And there was a stat whereby we've let in something like 40% of our goals, our conceded goals, about 40% of them, after the 17th minute. Now, I know that Motherwell scored in the 66th, but it's a real concern that, you know, for some reason, we are running out of steam about an hour into the game. Now, you've seen it again, Stephen, against Lille, where we're 2-0 up against them, much to everybody's surprise at half-time, away from home. You've seen it against AC Milan, you know, where in the San Siro. And there's been loads of occasions this season where we really have run out of steam. That's a huge concern.
You can trace that back as well, as far back as the Copenhagen game, when they got themselves into the Copenhagen, back into that tie, and ran out of steam and lost two late goals against Copenhagen. So there's been a pattern of that, as you say. That's quite a worrying trend.
Mm-hmm.
Not something, as you were rightly said, that you associate with Celtic. And it's, you know, and that's quite a startling stat that 40% of goals have been scored after a 70th minute. You know, is it fitness? Is it concentration? Is it a combination of both?
Yeah.
We have to be switched on. We touched on it the first. It's a prerequisite to play for a club like Celtic. You need to be switched on at all times. You know your job, know what you're doing. But it just seems to be that any slightest deviation from any kind of plan knocks everything out of kilter. I mean, could you believe when that goal went in how badly they failed to recover from it?
I know. It's almost as though today, the 93 minutes today, Tony, has shown us everything that's wrong about this season. You know, it's shown us all about how we failed to capitalise on the amount of possession that we had in the first half by simply scoring the one goal. It shows that one moment of the game can totally destabilise everything that we've built. And it also shows, I mean, I think the word baffling was used in terms of the substitutions. That's the best word for it. I mean, I can't remember a sub coming on and thinking, I can see what Lenny's doing here and why he's doing it. Ayeti, I want to see minutes in his legs. He gets taken off. Taylor, he's shown enough down the left. I think that we've got a great balance now between left and right. We've been screaming out for a bit of width. I'm not sure we need that width from our fullbacks, but that's the way we're going with it. We're going with the overlapping fullbacks. It was working, so why change it? The big thing for me as well, looking at that final third of the park, is it's been incredible this season, Tony, and this is, it seems kind of like an obvious thing, but it's a big issue this season. The team that we are playing plays us with their back to goal. We haven't done enough whereby they are being stretched, they're then on the back foot, and the reason for that is because we've not used the width and we're not stretching them enough. They're just sitting there soaking it up with their own goal behind them, and that's happened all season, and that's exactly what happened after Motherwell scored.
A lot of goals that Celtic have scored this season have been with players swivelling and turning, strikers. You know, there's not been many goals where Celtic have played the ball in front of the striker and he's run in on goal, despite the fact that we're playing these two, you know, charging forward wing backs, whatever you want to call them. You know, and that's worrying too, because if strikers are playing with their back to goal, then they're no use, are they? Because you want your strikers to play facing the goal that they're shooting, so that when their first touch comes, it's maybe a control bang, you know. And Odson Edward lost his way a wee bit because he was playing with his back to goal. Odson Edward is only effective when he's running at players, when he's facing the way the goal is. He's got the ball at his feet, you know, hopefully yards from goal, maybe beat a man, faint, shoot. You know, how many times have I not that I can recall.
You think back to when Neil Lennon played, you think back to the goal scored by Henrik Larsson. How many times have we seen it? It's on the counter, Tony. It's a fast, high-tempo move. And as I say, the opposition is facing their own goal because we're facing their goal. But in this scenario, where we are now with Celtic, it's this bank of defence, and they're all quite comfortable with that because they're watching the game play out in front of them, and we're playing the game in front of them, and they're happy to soak it up. So I thought that with Kenny coming in, it gave us a great bit of balance that we didn't have with Frimpong, and we've seen it over the last couple of games, and we were able to carve openings, you know, against fairly poor sides, it's got to be said. You know, Kilmarnock and Motherwell aren't great sides, but we were able to open them up in ways that we haven't been doing all season.
And you put the ball in front of a Yeti, you'll score, because I think there's a striker there. And a Yeti, I really do. You see, he hit the ground running at the start, and then he had injuries as well. But, you know, he scored a lovely goal against Hibs when Turnbull played him in. So you put the ball in front of him, he'll score. But he's already for that matter. So you know, you have to play to your strengths. You can't have these guys playing with their back to goal. It's too easy for the opposition defence then. You know, and if you're not getting it round the sides and into your forwards, then what are you doing? Where are you going? And you've rightly pointed out, you know, with Larsson and players like that, Hearts and Sutton, you got the ball in front of them. And then it was up to them to score. You know, they do their job, and they were quite clinical. But these guys, the two fouls that we have, only get the opportunity to be clinical because they're not getting many opportunities in a game. You know, Edwards had to swivel and bury that chance for the second goal. Thankfully, he did, because it turns out crucially to be the winner. You wouldn't have predicted that after he'd scored. You know, and it's microcosmic of everything that's happened. It just, something happened there and Celtic crumbled a bit. You know, and if it's a fitness issue, then that's serious. That's serious. That, you got to look at the management team and say, wait a minute, how can these guys know last 90 plus minutes? They're professional footballers. What do you do at training? Is there, there must be major fitness training. Obviously there is, but how can it be on a repetitive basis that we seem to be conceding late goals or goals late on, you know, continually?
You think about the new coaching staff coming in, Tony, and, you know, basically reviewing the season, assessing the season, assessing the players. They're going to be looking at things that are boldly obvious like that. You know, we're losing far too many late goals. Yeah, you know, data analysis goes a lot deeper than that. But, I mean, that's blatantly obvious, as is the situation with the goalkeeper, as is the lack of width. Now, in terms of the goalkeeper, loads of comments coming through on Twitter, Facebook and YouTube around Bain's performance, to the point where, you know, we almost threw away a two-goal lead there. Michael the Boy on Twitter says, yet again, look too tired after 70 minutes. And I think Autumn Glow makes a... That's a great name. Autumn Glow makes a great point by saying, this team is so frail. It is frail, isn't it? Everything's flying, but then a wee sucker punch, a goal, you should be able to overcome that, no problem. Get a third goal and you're on easy street. We go the other way, Tony.
Of course, I mean, you kind of bring it on yourself, as you say, but there seems no apparent danger at 2-0. But that's all it takes. A speculative whanner at goal, and Bain can't deal with it, and then all of a sudden, self-doubt creeps in. And then you think to yourself, well, why is self-doubt creeping in? Because you battered this team for 66 minutes up until this moment. Mm. So just revert to type. But then the game plan went out the window. Players started to panic. The hair on fire, the passing stopped, the slick, sharp stuff.
Hair on fire. That has been this season, isn't it?
Hair on fire.
The hair's on fire, yeah.
You know, the manager compounds it by taking off two of your best footballers on the day. What's going on?
It put me in mind, actually, Tony. Remember the 3-2 game against Livingston at Celtic Park? And they pull it back, again, long-range effort, they pull it back to 3-2. Had Effie Ambrose connected with that header? Was it Ambrose? He had a header near the end of the game. And there was a chance for Livingston, and they should have scored. They should have scored and made it 3-3. The same thing happens today. 93rd minute, you've got Laxalt scrambling back, and it was an important clearance because you've got a Motherwell player right behind them who would have just knocked it in had it came off the post. You know, so we're scrambling to win that game. We should be seeing that, you know, quite comfortably out.
As I say, they should have been battered 4 or 5-0.
Mm-hmm.
But Motherwell got encouragement from the fact that Celtic could plague with self-doubt once Alan Campbell scored. And he's just taking a speculative shot at goal. Honestly, speculative. And nobody more surprised than the boy that the ball went in when Bain made the rickets. And then Motherwell were like, right, let's go for this now. Let's go for this for the last 20 minutes or so, and almost pulled it off. Because after the last 20 minutes, Celtic didn't. There was a Tom Rodgick shot, which the goalie saved brilliantly, but Anil Yunusi deflected drive wide. But after that, they weren't much of an attacking force, were they?
No.
To my knowledge.
No, absolutely not.
It all just sort of fell apart.
Joseph McGonagall makes an interesting point, because it should never be the case that heads would go down. I mean, how do you go from 9 in a row quadruple treble winners to the heads going down because Motherwell score a goal? You know, and there was an element of that. Was there a deflection? There certainly was a wicked dip at the end. It was a speculative effort. It's ended up going in. But your head shouldn't be going down if you're playing for this Celtic side, you know, after the decade of success that we've had. You know, even if you're bringing in quite a number of players over the season. I mean, we've brought in 7 now. All 7 of them weren't playing. It's not as though the mentality and the culture has changed because we've got half a new team in. So, yeah, I find it absurd, Joseph, as well, that the heads could possibly go down. There was also mention here from Andrew Phillips. Thanks for commenting, Andrew. Why Turnbull off again? Let's talk a wee bit about Turnbull. I say it at half-time, and by the way, the second half performance doesn't change my mind about David Turnbull. We need to build our side around this player. I mean, anyone coming in, whoever the incoming manager is, and I do expect it to happen in the summer, we'll be looking at David Turnbull and thinking, well, you know, let's have a look at last season. Turnbull has been a shining light. I still think Soro's been a shining light. You know, I'd be making space for him in this side. And also Welsh, and we'll talk about Welsh as well. There's a young kid who's come through at centre half. Who was the last player to do that at Celtic? Was it McManus? Steve McManus coming through the ranks and actually playing more than 50 games for Celtic at centre-half. I think we've got one in Welsh. I think he could develop into that player. He looks so assured. And one thing as well, Tony, while we're speaking about him, I was talking during the week to someone who watched him regularly as a youth player. And what they say they haven't seen yet that is definitely part of his game is long-range passing. Apparently, his long-range passion. There's always passion, but his long-range passing is incredible, but it looks as though at the moment he's just trying to find his feet before he brings that into his game.
Well, I tell you what, if that's the case and he can ping 50, 60-yard passes, he's probably too scared to do it in this team at this moment in time.
Yep.
And he's keeping it simple and just trying to do all the things to make sure that he's selected next week. Because if he starts acting like Ronald Koeman, the first thing that would happen was Neil Lennon would take him off and bomb him back to, you know. So I think he's wise. He's switched on. He's clever. He's realised, right, no time for the Ronald Koeman impressions just yet. I'll get myself bedded in, feet under the table, and then I'll show them what I can do. Mm-hmm. And quite rightly so. Well, he scored a cracking goal today, a cracking header. Important header, as it turns out. So, yeah, I mean, good on him. But if he's got a range of long passing, I'd like to see it, but I would like to see it when he feels comfortable, when he feels an established player, because he probably doesn't feel that he's an established first-team player yet. So he wants to do that first.
Mm-hmm.
And Turnbull, it's just baffling with Turnbull. What does Lennon not see about Turnbull? Where's his blind spot with Turnbull? You know, where's his blind spot with Rogic that Rogic can do what he pleases?
There's a blind loyalty to players, I feel, like Tommy Rogic. You know, he gets so many games. And in many ways, you know, first and foremost, what I'll do here is I'll give Lenny a wee bit of credit when it comes to Frimpong, right? So Frimpong comes in as a 300 grand player from Man City. And at that time, Tony, I knew as much about O'Connor as I did about Frimpong. We brought in two fullbacks. And you think, well, if you put money on one of them, you're not quite sure where to go. You know, it could have been Leo Connor who progressed, who knows. He looked more likely because he was a full internationalist, or he has become a full international, Leo Connor. Highly rated at Manchester United. Looking through the Twitter comments of Man U fans, they were gutted that O'Connor had gone. So I've got to give Neil Lennon some credit. You know, it can't always be batter Lennon. And Frimpong developed. He developed into what became an 11.5 or £12 million player. So, but what one thing I would say is he played far too many games. There was times where he had four or five ineffective games, but he constantly got picked. And Lenny does have a blind loyalty for a lot of players. Scott Brown, some would say, as well. And, you know, there is certainly a blind spot when it comes to Turnbull. He is, for me, he's the main man of that Celtic team. He makes the team tick.
Yeah, correct. Because everything flows through him. And it's natural as well. He's a natural-born footballer.
Mm-hmm.
And he loves playing football. He's, you know, he plays with a smile on his face. And he just plays the way he would play down the park with his pals. You know, and that's a rare gift. You know, there's a comment coming in from Andrew Phillips, the most creative player subbed. We've said that. You know, he's just, I cannot, for the life of me, work that out, why you would take the best player and the most creative player on the field off with 10 minutes to go when it's 2-1, when the lead's precarious, when you're chasing a third goal that kills the game stone dead, and you take a man like that off. You know, only Lennon, Neil Lennon, can explain that decision, but to me it's inexplicable. I think every Celtic fan wrung their hands in their head and went, no, surely not. And you just couldn't believe it. You're thinking, anybody but Turnbull.
Anybody but, no, you're right. Now, the big thing for me is, you remember the famous quote from Alan Hansen, you never win anything with kids, and Man United went on to win the league with guys like Beckham, yeah. And it was the emergence of that class in 92. Now, at the beginning of the season, you know, I'm sure there would have been a few Celtic fans who would have thought the same had we not brought in a centre-half, and we were saying, well, you know, Julian and I are our first picks, but we're going to run with Welsh. But what he's shown, I feel, is that, you know what, he deserves that jersey. And Joseph Byrne comes in to say Welsh is showing Duffy how it's done. I absolutely agree with that. There was a game that Welsh played in Europe where he was talking. He was actually talking Diego Laxalt through the game. He was telling him where to stand at corner kicks. This is a guy who's played in the World Cup for Uruguay, who have got on loan from AC Milan. I honestly, people might think I'm gushing here about Turnbull and Welsh. I do feel that there is enough talent in this side that the incoming manager is going to identify that, and we're going to see guys like Welsh, Turnbull, Sorrow really progressing and flying next season.
Paul John, if we can see that, then any incoming manager will see that straight off the bat. Young Welsh has got an old head on his shoulders at the minute. You know, don't want to big him up too much because you know the nature of football. But he's slotted into that defence here, a defence which you've said earlier has been leaking goals right, left and centre, dropping points right, left and centre, fragile, frail, call it what you like. And the young man's come in there in the past few games and did a right steady, solid job. Because you know what he's done, he's defended. Right? When the ball's in the air, he's won it. And when the ball's in the deck, he's cleared it. And he's gave it to a footballer in the middle of the park, like Turnbull or whoever, down the side to John Joe Kenny. Mm-hmm. Kept it simple, right? I can't wait to see this Ranger passing because, you know, if he's got that in his armoury, then great. But he's just getting his confidence levels up just now. But he is, the comment there that he's shown Duffy, that's how you do it. Mm-hmm. Try and be something that you're not. Just defend. See when the ball, I mean that. I always say about defenders, see when the ball's in the air, go and challenge and win it. See when it's in the deck, cut it out. We'll work and finesse later. And if Wales can pass the ball 60 yards, brilliant. Look forward to that. You know, but he's unflappable at the minute. You know, and it might be easy to come into this team at the minute because it can't get any worse. There's that element to it. But it could get worse, you know. And it's a lot of pressure to put on a young man's shoulders to say, we need this second place. Don't mess it up. Here's a wee run in the team. Mm. Lesser players are, he's only young. Lesser players could crumble. Shane Duffy crumbled at the fact of playing for Celtic.
Exactly.
He's an internationalist. And Shane Duffy has crumbled because playing for Celtic somehow has become too much for him.
Mm-hmm. Chris Murray makes the point, Tony, exactly. Welsh never panics when the ball is played at him. Duffy is a trembling wreck. I mean, we've all come round to the way of thinking that it's simply not worked out for Duffy. It's been an expensive error. But if Stephen Welsh can do it, then surely some of his contemporaries, I mean, Scott Robertson, Ewan Henderson, why are these guys not, I mean, Robertson's been loaned out again. You know, why are these guys not getting game time?
Well, if you bring in a new management structure and they look at these guys, I always get back to you watch players in training. These guys must impress. You talked about the blind loyalty of certain players, the old guard. Probably Neil Lennon has that too much. But the Celtic fans want to see the Ewan Hendersons of this world, the Robertsons of this world. The only way you get experience is to be flung in there. Yeah, you might make mistakes, fine, but the Celtic fans will get behind players like that, because it's the only way you can, as I say, gain experience is by being flung in there, chucked in there, sink or swim, let's see what you've got. And you wouldn't be in and around the first team if you didn't have ability. So surely at some point, any new manager coming in would look at those players and say, do you know what? We've got a good crop of youngsters. The same as Man U did with the class of 92. Mm-hmm. I'm not saying any of the Celtic youngsters are as gifted, as talented as that, but there's talent there. You've got to give them a go at some point. You have to say to them, look, this is it. This is what you've trained all your life for. This is a moment you take the step up, you know? And I think Celtic fans would applaud that and would want to see them and see what we've got coming through. And if Welsh is anything to go by, then it's quite encouraging. Very encouraging, in fact, because I like the look of Welsh. I just don't want to put too much on his shoulders at the minute and, you know, label him and say he's this, that and the next thing, but just make steady progress, make that jersey yours, impress any possible incoming manager with your performances between now and the end of the season, and hopefully he gets to play between now and the end of the season. He's done nothing wrong so far.
No, Jim Hannaway makes the point. Henderson is a player. But what you want is you want to build players like Henderson up, and Conor Hazard, by the way, because we're going to talk about the goalie briefly. You want to build him up so they've got 20, 30, 40 games under their belt, you know. Incoming manager comes in, there's a guy that's earned his spurs. There's maybe a collection of four or five young players. That's before we talk about some of the youngsters that appeared in the two games post-Dubai when we were forced to play quite a few young guys. And I know that Cameron Harper's on his way out, but you've got a player there in Dembele who's, we've not developed him in the last two seasons. We haven't developed him. Simple as that. That young player has not developed under Neil Lennon, Karamoko Dembele. One minute he is the shining star of European football. England and Scotland are got a tug of war to try and cap him. The next thing, he's going to leave on a free. Looks like Oco Flex. You know, when we got Oco Flex, that was a coup because we were doing to teams like Arsenal what Bayern Munich are now doing to us. We were getting young, talented players under Brendan Rodgers, it's got to be said, and bringing them to Celtic Park. Now it's getting done to us, Tony.
It pains you, the Oco Flex and the Karamoko Dembele situation. It pains you as a Celtic supporter that's probably the outcome that's going to happen. They're going to leave the club for nothing because you've put so much into them. And because of the past couple of seasons or a regress in their development, that you're not going to see them. And Karamoko Dembele should have been in the first team a long time ago. You know, fleeting glimpses here and there, it's no use to anybody. And the whole of the crowd, whenever he came on, they were behind him, they were willing him to do well because they'd heard so much about him. You know, he was one of the few youth players that everybody knew about from an early age. Mm-hmm. You see, England-Scotland tug-of-war, he was, you know, I think he was put in the under-17 team when he was 14. You know, so that's a talent. You have to nurture that talent. You have to protect that. You have to wrap your arms around that and say, we will guide you to this first team because you have something to offer. And it's bordering on criminal that Karamoko Dembele would leave this club for nothing. Honestly, it really is, because somebody somewhere in the coaching side of Celtic really has to be taken or brought to task for that. He's are going to be deprived of a talent, and he's going to go elsewhere and probably thrive and shine because he'll be coached properly and he'll thrive on it.
Mm. Now, one last thing before we go, Tony. We love the crack, and Michael Graham is asking if you're in a cave. I was thinking more about, remember Red Dwarf? Remember Holly and Red Dwarf, the head?
I've just realised. Give me a second.
There we go. There we are. The lights are back on. Now, it's been an absolute pleasure, Tony. The half-time analysis was much different from the full-time analysis, it's got to be said, but we will always be here. And tomorrow, we don't have a live broadcast, but we will be back on Monday. Thank you, everybody, for getting involved in the comments section. YouTube, Facebook and Twitter. Get us followed, subscribe if you can. And all that's left for me to say until next week, thank you once again, Tony Haggerty, for joining us on A Celtic State of Mind.
Pleasure. Thank you.